Hello and welcome back to Proactive New York. Joining me today is Ben Lightburn, CEO at Filament Health. Ben, good to see you. How are you today?
I'm doing very well. Thank you, Christine.
Ben, the last time we spoke was earlier this year and around the June timeframe. The company had just begun trading on the NEO exchange. Since then, it has also upgraded to the OTC QB here in New York. Since then, you've had some few different milestones that you've achieved here. Namely, the most important, from my understanding, is the FDA authorization to begin your first clinical trial. Tell us the details here. When can you start?
Well, we received the authorization from the FDA a couple of weeks ago, so we are ready to start. Just putting in place the final few pieces of paperwork, and then we can begin patient recruitment. This trial is going to be run at the University of California, San Francisco, in collaboration with their TRIPR program and led by the director of their TRIPR program. His name is Dr. Joshua Woolley. We're incredibly excited and proud of this FDA authorization because it's going to mark two very important things. First is it's the first time the FDA has authorized a clinical trial which will employ the use of naturally derived psychedelic substances. All other trials up till now have used psychedelics that are produced artificially, synthetically in a lab. And we think that the natural approach has many benefits, not least of which is that consumers and patients prefer natural products in all aspects of their lives. So we're here to prove essentially that producing pharmaceutical grade clinical trial study drugs from natural sources of psychedelics is indeed possible. And this FDA authorization is validation of that. But perhaps even more importantly than being the first ever natural psychedelics clinical trial, is this is the first time that the active drug of the prodrug psilocybin will be administered. What do I mean by that? Contrary to popular belief, psilocybin is not actually active in the human body. It needs to convert into a closely related compound called psilocin. And this conversion process happens in the body, predominantly happens in the gut, but is absolutely necessary before psilocybin can become active in the form of psilocin. Because psilocin is actually very hard to manufacture synthetically and to make a stable form, and because all clinical trials, as I mentioned, have been done with synthetic psychedelics, to date, all clinical study has been centered on psilocybin rather than psilocin. But there are a number of potential advantages to administering psilocin directly. Those could be faster onset time, because you don't have to wait for this conversion to take place. This could be fewer gastrointestinal side effects because the conversion is thought to happen primarily in the gut. But perhaps most importantly, we expect to see a much more consistent effect from the dose. That's because different people metabolize and perform this conversion differently. Some people may convert all the psilocybin into psilocin. Some people may convert none, in which case they have a very variable effect from a compound which is already known to produce variable effects. So we think that we're going to be able to prove some of these benefits, or at least gain evidence for them in a clinical trial, because what we're doing is pitting psilocin directly head-to-head with our psilocybin formulation. So we're, like I said, we're incredibly excited to begin embarking upon this trial, and you know, within the next year or two, have data to perhaps have one of the leading clinical trial candidates, natural or synthetic, in the form of psilocin.
So have you started enrolling yet?
We haven't started enrolling yet. We're just about to get started with that very shortly.
And how many patients are you looking to treat here?
It's a phase one trial, so it'll be in healthy subjects. There's 20 patients, and it's within subject design. So the patients will receive actually four doses. They will receive our 25 milligram oral psilocybin capsule. They will receive our standardized natural psilocin oral capsule. And they will also receive a low dose of sublingual psilocin. We believe that the sublingual route of administration may bring even additional benefits to the administration of psilocin versus psilocybin. Again, faster onset time, fewer side effects by bypassing the gut completely, and perhaps, again, more consistent dosing. We think these all could be, in fact, amplified by administering the psilocin sublingually, And of course, it should be said that psilocin is the ideal candidate for a sublingual administration because sublingual administration avoids going through the gut. And if psilocybin needs to go through the gut in order to convert into psilocin, it's less optimal choice for sublingual delivery.
And you had said that you expect to get data within a year or two. If all goes to plan, what kind of opportunity do you see here?
Well, we'll set the stage for a full-scale pharmaceutical development program based on psilocin or maybe also as well our natural psilocybin. So we're really laying the groundwork and I think kind of blazing a trail for not just natural psychedelics, but psychedelics as a whole.
We'll look to follow your progress here, Ben. Thanks so much for getting on today. Appreciate it.
You're welcome. Thank you very much.